you have any inquisitive mind, you should ask why. One of the reasons why it has changed is that if with globalization, if you have to compete in the international market, you need an international chain. You need to be, you know, you need to have access to the international market in various ways and so on and so forth, both in terms of demand, supply, in various ways, distribution. And these small firms and companies cannot. I mean, the finance minister can all the time talk about that we are improving, or a politician can talk about we are improving the prospects of the small, you know, but it continuously cannot improve because of the fact that if you are emphasizing your productivity, if you are emphasizing your presence in the international market, small firms and small companies, except in very, very exceptional cases, are not in a position to do so. Except in a few things, like you might have a special design for textile, you might have a very special Ayurvedic, you know, you might have a niche, a kind of special technology, a kind of special knowledge might be, you get a small capture in a small international market where there is very little competition. But by and large, generally, you cannot do it. You have to enter the international market. And globalization, if you have to put it in one sentence, it, what did it mean? It meant a relative shift in emphasis from the domestic market to the international market. Right? And from the, and with the shift in the international market, it also became more or less, with early years of Manmohan Singh, it became a case where you have to emphasize how to be competitive in the international market and so on. Now this meant two different things. All of this you know, as I said, it's common sense, but it's a question of putting all this away. How do you make your presence felt in the international market? You have to have, you know, quality control, right? And if you do it with, say, for example, hand loom, you cannot get you very far in the international market because the quality differs from cloth to cloth. While machine can do it much better. You quality control, delivery on time, you know. If you depend on, let's say small fishermen to produce your shrimps and send it to Japan, you cannot do it because today the catch was not good. Yesterday your catch was good, and there must be some way of controlling it. And this is one of the big problems of international market. So you have to have on the time delivery, you have to have reasonable quality control. And this you can do with what? You can do with mechanization. So you introduce mechanization by the compulsion of being in the international market. And that mechanization also means that it increases labor productivity because you are substituting, you know, men by men and women by machines. So you have increased labor productivity. At the same time, your job opportunities goes up. That is why when India has 7% growth, it has 1% growth, less than 1% growth in people officially. That is why China, even today, it is a great success in terms of international growth and so on, until recently. But it cannot go on being that with traditional Chinese labor and so on. Their textile industry, for example, which grew at more than 20-25%. For several years and captured a very large part of the market. Could do it, but China's employment in the textile industry, in the World Bank study, China's employment in the textile industry reduced to about 40% of what it was. This is the same with our Tata Steel, this is the same with our all the corporations if you look at. Their output grows enormously there. You know, employment does not grow. Now, if you think of traditional management, if you think of traditional, what shall I say, traditionally what you are talking economists are supposed to sing the praise of efficiency. And after all, this is a case where people are more efficient. So, what are you saying? What am I saying? Am I saying that people should not be efficient? Productivity should be less? Where is the catch? You know, there are big economists like Schumpeter and so on, creative destruction, where this is done. So where is the catch? Why does it work? Just let's take one simple example and you will see. Suppose you have 10 people, each producing only 2, each one producing only 2. You will be producing how much per day? Okay. Now, you displace these 10 people with mechanization, with corporates. Each person produces, with a conservative estimate, 6 times more. Actually, the Indian figure is close to 10 to 11 times more. Produces 6 times more. Okay. 6 times more production means what? 6 times more production means each person, they are replacing who used to produce 2, is now they are producing 12 each. So 2 people produces how much? 24. 10 people are producing 20, 2 people are producing 24, and you are having a 20 by 4 by 20, 20% growth rate. Okay, you are having a 20% growth rate in that sense with a tremendous amount of unemployment. This is the crux. Now, why can't you employ all the 10 people? Yes, louder.
You don't need that much.
Why don't you need them? This is what I started by saying. Because your employment, what sounded like pure theory I was talking about, you can see an actual example here. You do not employ 20 people because the transmission is from the product market, demand in the product market, to the labor market. And if you actually employed all the 10 people, you would have produced 120. Where is the market for 120 people in the international market? India is not even an export surplus producer. Even China cannot do it. Even Japan finds, Germany finds it difficult to do it. The traditional successful exporters, none of them through export are able to solve the problem, unemployment problem, because of this reason. And India, which is in any case is not a particularly successful exporter. You can see it is your lack of the market where you can produce and sell your goods which constrains how much employment you can generate. Okay. That is why you have to employ 2 people, not 10. And the more you, under these circumstances, with a limited market, the more you automatize, the more you go in for mechanization, the more you have the problem of employment from that point of view. What in standard microeconomics you call capital labor substitution. Now, there is a problem which is inherent in this. The problem is, and this is where if any of you have the misfortune of listening to debates on TV on economic matters on a fairly regular basis, you will hear such stupid views and so on and so forth. Basically, what you very often hear is that, well, we have to be competitive in terms of exports. It is this international competitiveness which actually is, which becomes an obsession. That am I international? You see, for a corporation, individual management, for a management school, to say, teach that labor should be more efficient, you should have a higher efficiency, labor should produce more, I should have a corporation which requires less labor, which is lean, and which is producing a lot of profit. You know, in the Germans used to say lean and hungry. We want lean and hungry corporations, hungry for profit and lean in terms of employment, is a famous German expression. This is what would be the management dictum.